Hachette Audio presents BuzzFeed Unsolved Supernatural 101 True Tales of Hauntings, Demons, and the Paranormal. Written by Ryan Bergara, Shane Madej, and Anna Katz.
Read by Ryan Bergara, Shane Madej, and Marc Vietor. Introduction. Hey there, demons, it's us. No one really plans on becoming the internet's leading paranormal bad boys, but here we are. What began as a dip of the toe into the world of ghost hunting inexplicably evolved into a full cannonball, plunging us deep into a proverbial pool of ectoplasm. Make no mistake, it's grueling work, and we are heroes for it. With nary a complaint, we have endured nearly 6 long years of grime and sweat, swatting cobwebs and listening for whispers in the dark as we crawled through some of the world's straight-up freakiest locales. If that all sounds appealing, then bully for you on purchasing this audiobook. Herein you'll find a vast compendium of seriously spooky spots, from harrowing hotels to wicked watering holes, and every last nasty, ghoul-infested establishment in between. So steel your nerves and thumb on through, and we'll try our best to distract you from the horrifying details and downright depressing history of some of these decrepit destinations with our usual detestable yuck-em-ups.
And also, the fact that this series spawned a book is truly a testament to you guys. Holy moly, thank you. And sorry to inform you that you just made us both authors. Have fun explaining that one at the pearly gates, if you believe in that sort of thing.
We're excited to be recording this audiobook in the hallowed halls of Village Studios, the creative center for both music legends and major motion pictures alike. The Rolling Stones recorded here, as well as Janet Jackson, Fleetwood Mac, B.B. King, Bob Dylan, Lady Gaga, Whitney Houston for The Bodyguard, Shawshank Redemption, Kesha, and now, BuzzFeed Unsolved Supernatural.
The Village Studios was converted into a recording studio in 1968 by Jordy Hormel. The building was originally a Masonic temple built in 1922. It was later outfitted into a center of transcendental meditation for Maharishi Mahesh Yogi, well known as the guru for the Beatles. With all of the creative energy that this building has hosted for decades, it's no surprise that helpful spirits have manifested over time. The most famous legend is that there is a spirit in Studio A that drinks all of the liquor in the room and tunes bass guitars. That being said, let's get started.
Haunted Houses. The murders that haunt the Lizzie Borden house, Fall River, Massachusetts. Lizzie Borden took an axe and gave her mother 40 whacks. When she saw what she had done, she gave her father 41. To be accurate, Abby Borden was Lizzie's stepmother and was given a mere 18 whacks, while Andrew Borden received only 11. And the murder weapon was actually a hatchet, not an axe. Also, Lizzie was found not guilty, so, per official record, she technically gave 0 whacks.
You know, the inaccuracy of this schoolyard rhyme is unnerving. Next, you're going to tell me that when I'm sliding into first and I feel something burst, it's not diarrhea. I'm starting off this audiobook strong with a little thing we call comedy.
Not sure what's stranger, the fact that you referred to that as comedy or the fact that you made a sports reference. Either way, I think once you eclipse more than maybe 2 whacks, the rest is basically a wash, no?
Still, there's a reason why she attempted a rebrand by calling herself Lizbeth after the trial.
I gotta say, if I'm changing my name to Poo-Pourri the Stench off a double murder accusation, I'm definitely going more liberal than simply changing from Lizzie to Lizbeth. You gotta go with something diametrically opposed, like Shaq.
I think you're the only other person who could pull off Shaq.
Thanks, man.
For the rest of her 61 years, infamy would follow her, all the way to her big fancy house on the hill, a wealthy neighborhood nearby. Those who believe Lizzie was guilty point to money as motive, though she and her family lived on a diet of warmed-over fish and mutton. Mr. Borden was a rich man. Perhaps Lizzie had grown tired of her father's famous frugality, and so gave him a bunch of wax while he napped on the sofa in the sitting room.
You know, my dad loves tinned sardines, but I've never once killed him because of it. It just made me love snacking on those freaky little fish. I like that you can feel their bones crunching under the weight of your teeth.
Well, you're a psychopath, and I've never had sardines, and to be honest, after hearing you describe their bones crunching on my molars, I don't think I ever will.
It's your loss.
Gross.
Perhaps Mrs. Borden then walked in at an inconvenient moment, and so Lizzie was forced to chase her up the stairs and into the guest room to silence her. Mrs. Borden, with whom Lizzie had fallen out 5 years prior, died on the floor next to the bed, her blood soaking the rug.
You know, Ryan and I have actually visited this lovely home, and I regret to inform any true crime sickos looking to get their peepers on a viscera-stained rug that it looks like they called in Stanley Steamer to suck up all the blood and brains.
Jesus, man. Also, from a tactical perspective, and I'll preface this with the fact that I've never been chased up the stairs by a hatchet-wielding maniac, but if you're getting chased upstairs, don't you technically have some sort of high ground advantage after simply just turning around? I guess the hatchet negates that? Maybe I've watched that duel on Mustafar from Revenge of the Sith too many times. Obi-Wan's cocky, I might add. High ground warning still rings true in my head to this day.
Mrs. Borden is a central player in another theory featuring Lizzie as killer. According to its proponents, Mrs. Borden discovered Lizzie and the maid, Maggie, doing verboten dirty things to each other, and so they killed her. In this version, Mr. Borden is the one who walked in inconveniently and was hence dispatched.
I think this serves as a fair reminder for all parents to keep in mind that your children can and will kill you.
I hope you have kids one day.
That's sweet of you.
By the way, just going back to the Obi-Wan thing, you know what I'm talking about, right? When he goes, I have the high ground, Anakin.
Yeah, no.
You know
I,
what I'm talking about?
The, I gotcha.
The high ground warning?
You've talked about it enough.
I say it all the time when I play Smash Bros.
Okay.
Some blame John V. Morse, the uncle of Lizzie and her sister, Emma. He and Mr. Borden were struggling over a failing shared enterprise. Or maybe it had something to do with Mr. Borden's will. Either way, Mr. Morse's whereabouts are unaccounted for from 9 a.m. to noon on August 4th, 1892, the oppressively hot day of the murder.
Probably at the swimming hole.
Eating some slightly wet sweet tarts, God willing.
Slightly wet sweet tarts?
Ambrosia.
All right.
Then there's the mysterious Portuguese man who allegedly stopped by the house to collect wages he was owed. Of course, someone might have noticed a Portuguese man drenched in blood walking down 2nd Street in broad daylight. To this day, no one knows who done it. Lizzie died in 1927 and was buried next to her father, stepmother, and sister under a gravestone with the name Lisbeth.
Tell me this gravestone is not instantly improved by reading Shaq instead. I dare you.
R.I.P. Shaq. You know?
Yeah, I mean...
You know what I mean?
A big-ass grave. It's going to be a big-ass grave.
That'd be a big-ass grave.
Do you think Shaq will have a giant tombstone as well?
I hope so.
Guests can stay in the very same house in which these gruesome murders occurred. Rooms include breakfast of what the Bordens had that morning, minus the mutton. If you stay in Andrew Borden's room, leave some coins, or at least don't take any. His ghost is known to scratch those who part him from his money.
Pro tip to all the Shaniacs out there, free coins at the Borden house.
I didn't realize we could have had breakfast there.
Well, it probably would have been a better option than the Outback Steakhouse we went to before the investigation in Massachusetts. That's a Massachusetts Outback Steakhouse.
Yeah, those Borden bathrooms are now consequently equally haunted.
The Abusive Witch of Bellwitch Farm. Adams, Tennessee. For 13 years, the Bell family lived comfortably on their new farm along the south bank of the Red River in Robertson County, Tennessee. Then, in 1817, strange animals began to visit the fields, and late at night, knocking rattled the walls.
Exactly what brand of strange are we talking here? Are we talking like a cow with super long udders or something extra freaky like an inside-out chicken?
Yeah, inside-out chicken is fun, or like a pig with a bacon addiction, or maybe like a Like a dog with huge balls.
What dog? I've seen that.
Oh, shit. Do animals who eat their own kind consider themselves cannibals? Like, are there Hannibal Lecters in the animal kingdom?
Huh.
The family awoke to the sounds of choking, stones dropping, chains dragging, dogs fighting, and rats gnawing on the bedpost. But when they lit a candle, the noise ceased.
Pure nonsense, spouted by imbeciles.
Huh, I guess ghosts like it a little more spontaneous.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.